is showing all the samples that I ended up collecting, I ended up with 1,293 soil samples, and that's from the top like 2.5 centimeters of soil, so basically just like a little shovelful. And I got at least 15 samples from all 24 census tracts in Lafayette to try to account for the entire city. And I did this by just sampling public places where I was allowed to go. We had permission from the Lafayette Consolidated Government. And then I know several of y'all like invited me to come sample, or people mailed samples in. There was a few different methods of like obtaining soil samples. A lot of it was just me like driving around, jumping out my car, and like getting a little bit of dirt. And then I also did 13 of the parks here. There's 25 total, so I did 13, and they're spread out as well throughout the city. And our goals here with the project were to collect samples that would be representative of the whole city, and then test those for heavy metals. And we did 9 different heavy metals, metals and metalloids, so like maybe things like arsenic and like mercury as well. And we tested this with a machine called an XRF, so it's an X-ray fluorescence spectrometer. It really is like a barcode scanner, and it reads like 50 different elements concentrations. It's a very interesting machine. I think they only came about maybe in like the 90s or so, and so it's kind of a novel technique. Like not everyone has one, so it's really special also that aspect of this project. And then we wanted to involve the local residents, so we asked like the news to advertise our need for soil samples and different things. And we also wanted to just make people more aware of the problem of heavy metals in soil, and like the fact that you need to get your soil tested before, especially when you're going to grow like food crops. So so here's a bit more about like how specifically I sampled. This is kind of just like a basic residence diagram. So like I did people's like lawns, like front and back, I did the street signs, and then the drip line samples. And then like I said, I got 15 from each census tract. I also did gardens, so I did like home gardens and community gardens. And then yeah, the 13 parks, I did like all of downtown and several other just like commercial areas. So some basic answers here. What are heavy metals? So heavy metals are inorganic contaminants. They come from many, many different sources, like a lot of industrial usage or like pesticides. Even fertilizers can have it, you know, just emissions from chemical factories, gasoline emissions, especially before we banned leaded gasolines. And heavy metals are also a huge problem in the environment because they don't go away. Like they have such a high density, and they can stay forever, even in the smallest particles. Like you can't even see it, and it'll still be in the soil from 100 years ago, 50 years ago. You know, we see a lot of lead in places where people's houses are painted with lead paint, and like that soil has been contaminated, you know, since that house was built in like 1900 or whatever. And you know, it's like we have never found metals to degrade. So you know, they say like metals will last hundreds of years in the soil, but we actually don't even have research that goes back further. Like they last indefinitely, basically. In the soil, which can definitely be a health hazard for people. Different heavy metals cause a huge range of problems. This chart kind of shows just a few of them for cadmium, lead, copper, and zinc. My research specifically focused on lead and like health problems associated with lead contamination, because that is the most prevalent issue of soil contamination, would be the health effects of lead exposure. So like I said, lead is non-degradable. It lasts, you know, indefinitely. And some of the main sources of lead are things that we call legacy lead. So like legacy lead is lead concentrations that were deposited in the soil like decades ago. A paint is, you know, caused a lot of contamination because lead paints weren't banned until 78. And then leaded gasoline wasn't banned until 96. And like, that wasn't even like a hard deadline. Like, it still was just being phased out then. And still today, like, even certain types of cars, certain types of machines are still using leaded gasoline. So like near street sides, you know, there's more lead because of the gasoline emissions. And then by house sides, you know, it's all the lead from the paint. So there's a few different sources. And then we find lead as well in older industrial areas, just from like metal smeltering plants or just their atmospheric emissions settling into the ground. So lead specifically is a neurotoxin. So there's several other heavy metals like cadmium, mercury, you know, they cause cancer. Like high exposures to a lot of heavy metals cause different types of cancers. Lead specifically, like high levels can lead to cancer as well, but it mainly affects your development. Like, it's very dangerous for children to be exposed to because children are still developing, like their bodies and their mentally still developing. So like being exposed to lead stunts that. So it can result in like lower IQs and like just cognitive disabilities, like impaired movement. And it really presents itself a lot with like behavioral issues, like even like ADHD or like anger problems for children that are exposed to higher amounts of lead. And the way that we measure this is through blood lead levels, which is a blood test that not all children are subjected to. Like, it's typically only children that are on some type of government subsidized health insurance are required to have this testing done. So like, that's a problem I ran into with this research, via limitation. A lot of children in Lafayette haven't even been tested for lead poisoning. So like, you know, I'm about to tell you that there's not that many children here that have an elevated blood lead level, but it also goes to say that not that many children have even been tested. So that is a factor as well. One thing that inspired me to add on an environmental justice aspect of my project, like, so I do want to be an attorney, so I've always been interested in kind of like the policy side of things and kind of like, you know, the environmental injustices, justice, like I'll be studying that in school next fall. But yeah, so environmental justice, for those that haven't heard of this, I know it's kind of a more recent concept, is just that like all people, regardless of your race, age, wealth, educational attainment, should be able to live in an environment that's not going to be detrimental to your health or your children's health. Everybody deserves to have an environment that is safe for you to play in, or just so you don't have to worry about having all these health problems just from playing outdoors. Some other environmental injustices in Louisiana. So, have y'all heard of Cancer Alley? Yeah, so that's like a present day issue that is still going on. It's this industrial corridor. It stretches about, I think it was like maybe 100 miles, 50 miles, I can't remember now, but it's from like Baton Rouge to New Orleans. And there's over 200 active petrochemical plants there. And it's mostly black or low income communities there. So they're disproportionately affected by the cancer rates. This map actually is of cancer rates. So you can see like the red along this whole corridor is where the cancer rates are a lot higher. And it's also where it's mostly all like black or low income people. So also another issue of like environmental injustice in Louisiana is in New Orleans. So I mirrored my study here basically off of several studies that have been done in New Orleans. And in New Orleans, just like Lafayette, you know, the oldest part of the city is the inner city. And that's where most of the contamination is. But in New Orleans, the city center is mostly like black Black or low-income people. However, here in Louisiana, or in Lafayette, I mean, we don't really see the same trend. It's not that Black people or white people are being exposed to more lead contamination or heavy metal contamination in general, because here in Lafayette, our contamination is in the historic city center too, but that area is populated almost equally by Black and white people. The better predictor for that would be income, or like your economic status. So census tract one, which is like just right in the middle of town, you can see it's where this darker area is and all the triangles. So the triangles there are like really high lead concentrations. Like it's over 400 milligrams per kilogram. The dots are over 200. So 400 is the Louisiana Department of Environmental Quality Standard. The EPA recently lowered that to 200, which is still pretty high. You know, there have been lots of studies done that say, you know, 50 milligrams per kilogram is more of like a safe exposure level of lead per soil. So these are, 200 and 400, it's really, that's a lot of definitely dangerous concentrations. And like you can see, they're all concentrated right there in the middle of the city, in the oldest area of town itself. And then on the other maps, you can see that Lafayette is basically like split, like white people and Black people, but the middle census tract where all the contamination is about 50-50. And then it corresponds to basically the amount of people there that are below poverty. That's a connection. And then also comparing this to New Orleans. So this is a map that I made of the blood lead levels we have for our children here. The orange, like darker census tracts, we have less than 6% of the total child population has a blood lead level between 5 and 10 micrograms per deciliter. So that's less than 6% of the total population in each of these census tracts, so just like a few children. And then like comparing that to New Orleans, where they have over 30% of all of their census tracts have children with over 10 micrograms per deciliter, as well as soil concentrations that are way over 400. And like studies have been done, a lot of these New Orleans studies have proved the connection between high soil lead levels and high blood lead levels from children just being exposed outside. So like I said, this is the main trend of the main finding, is that all of our lead contamination is close to the city center and it decreases as we move away from that. So this map is the census tracts. And like you can see, the highest ones are in the middle, and then like the outer side, the outer city census tracts are a lot lower. These are median soil lead levels too, which I would like to say that the median isn't always necessarily a great indicator of soil contamination, just because there can be such extreme hotspots, like such extreme concentrations that we find in just random places. So also like in the outer part of the city, there are not like extreme outliers that are really high concentrations of lead. Like it's all generally very low. And then in the city center, like with the map here, you know, like all the triangles and dots are the really elevated lead concentrations. So I really like this map. When I found this, I was like so giddy, because this map at the bottom is from the Sanborn Fire Insurance Company. This map is from 1928, and in 1928, this was the entire extent of the city. So like the whole city of Lafayette was in this little area, which I lined up with the box on the map I made of today. And you can see that like they line up extremely well. Like the city of 1928 is basically the exact outline of all of our really high lead concentrations. And like that's due to this legacy lead influence from like the older houses having paint deterioration. There was more traffic that was using leaded gasoline for longer in the city center. And this is also where most of our industrial activity was at the very beginning. So I also looked at the median year houses were built and found a connection between that. A statistically significant connection was found between houses that were built before the 1970s were directly correlated with the higher lead levels. And that's just due to the paint deterioration. And like, even if your house has been repainted, you know, that lead can still be in the soil from when it was sanded or chipped off or anything like that. This also demonstrates just the way that the lead concentrations decrease as we move away from the city center because the houses also get younger. Lafayette definitely has the scheme of urban sprawl where they all started in the middle and then everybody started just kind of spreading out and moving out. So the houses are older in the middle and they get younger and there's more lead in the middle and then it, you know, dissipates as you move outward. So like I've compared a lot of this to New Orleans because like I said, I mirrored this study off of Howard Milkey studies there, but I also looked at Baton Rouge and compared to these other two cities that are, you know, they're older and they have more industry, higher traffic congestion, and more older homes, they have higher medians for lead, and then a whopping maximum in New Orleans at 52,000 parts per million for lead. Like, that is just a result of a high impact of like legacy lead in the inner city of New Orleans from all the industries and everything that's been going on in New Orleans since the 1700s basically has accumulated to this. So these are, this diagram here is showing the parks concentration. So I did 13 different parks. I know like several of y'all live around like the Oaklawn Park. I think the key thing here is to say that these are low, like these concentrations are very low. The highest level we found in a park was in J.W. James Park at 203, and that park is located close to the historic city center, and it is also in a predominantly Black and low-income neighborhood. But overall, the samples we took from the parks are low. And this is because most of the parks here in Lafayette were agricultural land. Like they haven't been a factory or something else that's been torn down and like rebuilt as a park. Like a lot of major cities are repurposing like landfills or like old factory sites into parks and they're finding like crazy high lead and other heavy metal concentrations in the parks just because, you know, they thought it was a good idea to repurpose the land, but you know, the contamination persists for so long. But here in Lafayette, like Moncus Park, many of the parks here, they've either always been a park or been a park for a long time, or they were just agricultural land to begin with, or like kind of just natural and like untouched types of places. So I think that this is like, you know, this is good news for us because, you know, you can take your children to the park and you don't really have to be like worrying about them getting exposed to lead. Whereas like in New Orleans, you might worry about that. So I also did a lot of gardens throughout the city and we found a really pretty high range of soil levels, and I did all different types of gardens, different types of soils. So like other people's houses, and then like I said, I did community gardens. So I did like the Freetown Community Garden and the Little Disciples Community Garden, which these are great projects that are going on, but you know, I think that it's important to understand that soil needs to be tested before you're going to go directly into it, especially in these older parts of town. Like the community gardens that I measured have all been in like this historic city center section. So like we did find some somewhat concerning levels, you know, I know like there was some okra in one of them that like returned a pretty high level of lead. So, you know, we tried to stress to those people that like, you know, you either like you need to test your soil before you're doing it, or it needs to go remediated or some kind of thing. But what we really recommend is just doing a raised bed and like not planting directly in the ground unless you know for a fact that like it's clean and that it's not been contaminated by anything. So yeah, I mean the highest concentration we found in a garden was 291, which is pretty high. Like, you know, 50 is where we start seeing the adverse health effects. So you're definitely not wanting to like eat something that has been grown in 291 milligram soil. But we find that, you know, the raised beds, we did statistic tests on all of these, and the raised beds are just so much better compared to either amended soils or original soils. And like by original, I mean that like, you know, it hasn't been touched. Like it's just the ground basically. And then amended would be like, you have like landscaping, like you've put compost or mulch or like something. It's somewhere between original and a raised bed. You know, it's like you've done a few things to make it better, but you know, it's not a raised bed that's been built with like completely clean materials. This graph here is like a huge overview of everything that I measured. So from the left to right, I did busy roads. So places like Johnson Street, Ambassador, Caffrey, Cali Stillium, those kind of places, and then industrial areas. So Census Tract 8, I believe. It's kind of, you know, out kind of close to Carriage Road towards like the northwest of the city. There's lots of industrial activity going on out there. So I took lots of samples from there. And then I also included the downtown area in the industrial section. And then you can see the parks are, it's pretty small compared to the rest of them. And then also we tested UL's campus, which we did find some high concentrations, which is expected. UL was established in 1898, and in the oldest part of campus, we found, I think it was 700 milligrams per kilogram of lead, which is pretty high. And then, you know, closer to like the buildings that are oldest, we found higher concentrations because of like the paint deterioration. And then the street sides around campus had some high concentrations as well. And then for residential areas, so like for people's houses, we split up the samples into foundation samples. So those are the drip line, the ones that I took directly from the sides of the house. And then also street sides and open spaces. So like open spaces are like lawns or like vacant lots in the neighborhood. And then also the gardens. So we did find also a statistically significant difference between both foundation and street sides from the open space samples. So like the open spaces like lawns are just generally less contaminated than the houses and street sides, which goes back to the legacy lead from paint and gasoline. But you know, it's worth saying that open spaces can deceive you because you have to really know the complete land use history to assume that an open space is going to be uncontaminated, because there could have been a building there years ago that's been torn down and like you don't even know that it was there, or you know, something else such as that. Like, I know I had one place where a lawnmower, like, spilled a bunch of stuff, had, like, a wreck or something, and, like, that resulted in really high, like, metal contamination as well. So, you know, it's a good idea to just be very cautious, really, no matter what, especially if you have young children that are going to be playing in it. Let's see. So, yeah, like, overall, like, the key findings that I found here, I would say that in Lafayette, especially compared to other big cities, we have a low incidence of lead contamination and a low incidence of children that have high blood lead levels, which the two of those things are directly linked, so that does make sense. But like I said, a lot of the children have not been tested. So I think as part of this research, that's also been something that we're stressing, is like, you know, just because your kid is not tested doesn't mean they don't have, like, a lead problem. You know, like, avoidance isn't really, like, a solution to that. But, you know, that goes back to just, like, the health insurance situation, like, doctors not, you know, making you or suggesting it to parents, you know, that they could have this test done. Because it's just a blood test that they could have done at their, just like, doctor's visits. So the general trend in Lafayette is that the outer city is younger and it has less contamination. And the inner city is the oldest part of the city and it has most of the contamination for lead along with all the other ones just because of the legacy lead inputs from gasoline, paints, and industry.